through what's coming on. So next in the line is actually me speaking about confidential computing. So we go more into some of the deep dive, some of the hardcore capabilities of Azure, not particularly explored yet on a mainstream level. And I'll tell you why in a moment. Before we do so, though, I want to point you to an initiative that Microsoft has announced a few days ago, which is very much in line with Dorani's presentation around Power Apps, the Power Platform in general. If you go to Microsoft.com, you will see that there is a new initiative, new skills for job seeker. Microsoft has announced of a sort of delivery of a free training. They want to train up to 25 million people globally, people that have been affected by this situation. Maybe they are in a need of a new career, or they are considering reskilling for a different job. So the start from there. Start from Microsoft.com, this new skill for job seeker initiative, and you will find a lot of resources. And if you don't know already, just head to Microsoft.com/learn, okay? And this is a free portal with an incredible amount of training materials for all the different products, for Azure, Dynamics, Power Platform, and most of these learning paths lead to proper Microsoft certifications. All right, so this was just sort of giving you the heads up on this. What I'm gonna do now is start my session. And before we do so, as usual, let me share with you the survey link one more time in the chat, especially for the people that have joined now this session recently. So this is a survey that you can fill in for giving some feedback on what you want to see in the next events. If you head to the 365portal.org, you will see that we have events every week. Last week, we focused on chatbots. This week, on the Azure platform. Next Saturday, we have another event about Teams. Everything that you want to know about Teams, from governance to security to developing apps. And also, because you've been so good staying with us on this Saturday, there is one more form that if you submit, you will have the possibility to participate in a prize competition at the end of this day, kindly offered by Nigel Frank International. The prize is the possibility to attend an AZ-900 preparation exam. AZ-900 is a certification for Azure Fundamentals. So if you are sort of new to Azure, this event today is great to get your head around Azure. Then Microsoft.com/learn for progressing your training on proper learning path, and then take the exam. So AZ-900 is a way to certify your knowledge. It's not a challenging exam. There are other exams that require a bit more experience, a bit more knowledge. This AZ-900 is Azure Fundamentals. So as the name implies, is really about getting started with Azure. So just give it a try. You will find that is really exciting to get into Azure if you're not yet. But let's carry on now with my session, because I want to talk to you. Here we go, sharing. All right, I want to talk to you about confidential computing. Confidential computing is a combination of hardware and software resources. And there is a very strong partnership between Microsoft and Intel. Confidential computing is about protecting your data, is about protecting your code, and is about doing this in the cloud, on premises, in your own data center, starting from hardware. We'll see that in a moment. And I will go also through some very specific scenarios, some specific use cases where it makes sense to implement the confidential computing. So, this has been in the news a few times in the past years, data leakage, data breaches, very, very serious matter. I always joke that a few years ago I met a CIO for big organization. We're just talking around the security posture of the company, and he mentioned to me, "Oh, look, a few weeks ago we had a DDoS attack, a distributed denial of service attack that took our website down, but likely we didn't lose any data as long as he knows. So, we are all right now." So I asked him, "Oh, well, okay, DDoS attack could compromise the availability of your system, but if they take down your system and then identify some vulnerabilities, then they can even penetrate your perimeter, your network, and steal some data. What did you do about it, not to protect?" And I was genuinely curious about it. And he said, "Ah, no, don't worry. Look, it never happened to us in 10 years," which is true. That was the first time in 10 years that they had a website that happened to them. So we paid the duties. It's not gonna happen again. Well, sort of facepalm, right? Don't be that guy. Data breaches, cyber attacks is a serious matter, and we need to protect your data. We need to prevent unauthorized people to access your data. We need to protect even internally by employees, not necessarily intentionally stealing data, sometimes accidentally, assuming that they can share a file or they can copy a file on a USB drive, they can take it home. So we want to make sure that there is a confidentiality at any stage of running our application, our infrastructure. And now, this is why about a year ago, Azure has introduced the concept of confidential computing, which is take a step further the typical security matters, precautions that you will have in a cloud-based system. So confidential computing is a double layer of security. It's security that you get at hardware level and at software level by building enclaves, so sort of closed spaces called trusted execution environments. Your applications and your data run inside a TEE, which is a black box. It's completely isolated from anything else around, and only systems that have a key to access this TEE can access this information, this data. Now, I'm pretty sure that you guys are all familiar with the concept of data at rest and data in transit, I mean, encryption at rest, encryption in transit. So we protect our data when it's inside any form of storage, BitLocker for a file system, databases that can be encrypted. When our data is there, stored, no one is using, it's still encrypted. Then we have to take the data out of a database, or a file system, or a blob storage, and transfer it to an application, to a website, to use it. So that is the transit that happens. And there are different ways if you're of protecting data. If you're using web, then you will be familiar with HTTPS, obviously, so TLS for protecting your data in transit and encrypting this data. But there is a missing component here. When the data is in memory being used by an application, at that point is unprotected. Now you can say, oh, okay, but this is running inside a virtual machine, inside a container, inside some server that is hosted in a data center. Absolutely right. So there are a lot of levels of protection before getting into the memory of the server where the data is running, where the application is running. But still, data at that point is still potentially vulnerable. So this is where confidential computing enters into action, in protecting, in encrypting data when it is in use, in memory, during computation. Okay, so how that happens? It happens because we have a problem, or potentially we have a problem. We have a problem of trusting applications, trusting infrastructure providers, and trusting hardware vendors. When this memory is in RAM, in the memory running, who has access to it? The application that you have built, for sure. But how about the Windows or Linux administrator? They can, with a memory dump, with a debugger, they can explore what's happening in that memory space. And even your hardware vendor can have access to this information, because at the end you're running the application on your data on their hardware. So we need to create trust, an increased level of trust. Trust with the application provider, trust with the Azure provider. One of the reasons that I always keep on hearing is when hosting data in a cloud provider, the like of Azure or any other public provider, is how can I trust the guys at Microsoft? They're not going to go into the virtual machine where I store my data and steal it. We may argue on this, and it's not the place for having this sort of conversation, but there is a problem there, and we need to address it. So confidential computing is about addressing this lack of trust by creating trust at hardware level, hypervisor, operating system, and even preventing the Windows administrator, the Linux administrator, the operating system, the host administrator, the virtual machine administrator, whoever has access to that server, to have a look into their data. I'm going to show you exactly how it looks like in a moment, actually. Okay, so we need to create this data. We need to reduce the attack surface. If you are familiar with security practices, your attack surface is basically all the endpoints where your application is subject to an attack. And a web application, for example, is subject to session injection, to session hijacking, SQL injection. So your URL passing parameters into a query string that can compromise the result, and so on. A database can be compromised by connecting to the database, stealing data. So the attack surface are all the elements, all the components of your application that are potentially vulnerable. We need to reduce that. So in this case, for assuming that you are the most expert security engineer and your application is super secure and it runs encryption at rest and in memory and in transit, still your attack surface, for as much as it reduced it could be, has a little vulnerability because your data is running in memory, visible to an administrator of their virtual machine. Now, we're not here to protect us only from Windows administrators running our virtual machine in Azure. We are here because that element is potentially a weak point, a vulnerable point that does extend also beyond Azure. Assume that you are running virtual machines on premises, then you have to rely on the administrator of your own local infrastructure. Can you trust them? I'm sure you can. But how about we don't just ask the question, we make sure that we do trust them because there is technology that can make this happen. So I'm sure you're getting the point. So confidential computing, you get a starting point at the URL you see on screen, azure.microsoft.com/solution/confidential-compute. Safeguard data from malicious users, maintain control of your data across the entire lifetime, so at rest, in transit, and in use. Protect and validate your code as well, because not only you're running data, you're also protecting your application, your code. I will show you that in a moment. But the thing that I love the most of what these four selling points of confidential computing is the last one. Confidential computing ensures that your data and code is opaque, so not visible to the cloud platform provider. So not even a Microsoft employee who is an administrator of that virtual machine, of that container, where you're running your data in the cloud, can see that data in any possible way. They can steal the hard disk, they can plug it somewhere else, they can use a debugger to see what kind of data you're reading. There is no way they can see that. And this is done for two in two ways: using an SGX hardware security guard extensions that are extensions to regular normal Intel CPUs, and at hypervisor level. So, okay, the why we already understood. So what happens is that basically in a typical virtualization environment, you have a host, CPU, hypervisor, operating system, and then the app that runs. This app, as we have understood, is visible to a lot of all of these levels. So then we basically, by introducing protection with SGX, we are encoding, so we are sort of encrypting data using CPU capability or the extension to these CPUs by creating an enclave or TEE, Trusted Execution Environment. This enclave, which again is run, is protected by this SGX extension at CPU level, basically take your code, take your data, and run it in a completely encrypted, separated web space that no one can access. So at the end, you have hardware protection, and for those virtual machines that don't run on Intel SGX extension, you can achieve the same software level using some protections I will explain in a moment that are part of the hypervisor itself. But at the end, we are basically taking your application and your data out of the normal memory space, allocating a separate memory space that is completely encrypted, and everything runs inside that trusted execution environment or enclave. Okay, this is what is available now in Azure. In Azure, you can create this type of virtual machine that have the Intel SGX extensions. So when you create a virtual machine, you will have an opportunity to have there is a checkbox to identify that these VMs are protected with confidential computing. This is not a proprietary initiative by Microsoft. There is a confidential computing consortium that is made of different providers that have an interest in security. It is all open source. There is a GitHub repository. I'll share that in a moment. So Microsoft is a founding member of this consortium. As you can see on screen, there are a lot of other logos in there. Intel obviously is one of the key player, and they're basically building this consortium for creating a confidentiality in different applications. So let me show you a few use cases first, and then we'll go a little bit into the technical part of it, how this is actually implemented. Okay, so we understood the challenge that we have. What is the solution at a very high level? Azure Confidential Computing. So let me share with you now how this is actually used for to resolve what kind of problems. So we can also contextualize these in very specific use cases. And then I'll talk on how this is done. What is the a bit deep dive into the technology itself. Okay, so first of all, confidential computing can help in protecting your data, in protecting application that you don't want this data to be exposed outside. There is an open enclave SDK that helps to build this kind of security, and I will show that in a moment how to use it basically. A typical application is in a consortium of organizations that they want to share or need to share data among themselves, but not necessarily are open to sharing protected or sensitive information. A blockchain network can be an example, but it doesn't have to be blockchain. It's any space, any context where we have multiple parties that need to share some personal or sensitive data, but don't want the other party to have access to it. Think, for example, of some bank institutes or hospitals, health institutes, that they have sent a large data set of sensitive information, and they're running some machine learning. This machine learning will help them identify some potential fraud or help them develop a new cure for some disease. So the larger the data set, the better is the accuracy of the prediction of machine learning. In a blockchain context, when we decentralize the data, and we need all parties to agree for a consensus to approve a transaction. Again, you are sharing a lot of information with all the parties. You don't want all of them to see what all the transactions are, but you want basically to validate a transaction, and then this has to be based on information stored in the digital ledger. So there are a few scenarios where you have multiple parties involved that they don't necessarily want to share information with each other, but they need to, because this will provide increased accuracy of prediction of an algorithm or consensus on approving transactions in a peer-to-peer network. Anything that basically say something like, I trust you because you are part of the same consortium, but I don't really want to trust you too much. So I need to rely on technology to prevent the other parties to see what I'm doing. So, how that happens? It happens basically by sharing data and the application code. Not actually sharing, but protecting data and application code in an enclave. Virtual machines At the moment, this is available for virtual machines of the DC2 series on Azure. They communicate with an external client over a protected channel, and this channel is obviously encrypted. This channel the communication with this channel is authorized only to client application that have a sort of certificate. This certificate is provided by an attestation server. This attestation server runs also, or is a Windows server technically, provides the key to access this information. Now, in the context of a multiple network, a network with multiple parties, what it means is that all the parties, all the members of this network, basically share their data and their code with this enclave. This enclave protect data from other parties because you are encrypting your data with your own key for protection, and the enclave is the only space that is allowed to decrypt this data. So it's basically like saying, I share this data set with a common environment, the trusted execution environment, that everybody else has access, but no one can see what's happening inside there. I have a very specific use case that I want to share that I worked in the past. One is we have a machine learning that is running inside this enclave. So remember, the enclave protect data, but also applications. So you can run code inside the enclave. This enclave allows different banks, in this case, to share their data set. So each bank uses the public key of the enclave to encrypt their data and send it to the enclave. The enclave will use its own private key that is only visible inside the enclave, so no other banks has access to the private key of that enclave, to decrypt that information. So even if in transit the data is hijacked, there's not a problem, because it is encrypted and only the enclave can decrypt it. Even if an administrator of bank 2, bank 3 steal data from the enclave, data that bank 1, for example, has shared, they can't do anything about it because the key is inside the enclave and the bank 2, bank 3 don't have access to that data, to that key. So the enclave is a completely separate entity that you have access only if you have a key to share this data. And the same, and a similar approach can be used also when dealing with patient data. I have a quick demo to show you exactly how a machine learning algorithm that I developed, running completely in a TEE, a Trusted Execution Environment, bumped the accuracy of prediction from about 80% to 98% by combining different data sets provided by different institutes, different hospitals. So these health facilities, they have their own patient data. They don't want this patient data to be shared with other health facilities, even if this is meant for something good, like developing a new drug or finding a cure, or helping for the benefit of the entire population, but still there is some patient data that is confidential, and also patients trust the health institute that their information is not shared outside of the hospital itself. So in this way, it's still possible to share separate individual sub data set without compromising privacy on it. I'll show that in a moment a bit more in detail. First of all, if you want to get started to get your head around confidential computing and SGX, a few resources here on screen, just to get more into the specific range of applications that ACC protects, and also what this Software Guard extension do for protecting code and data at hardware level. So these are a couple of resources for you to expand your knowledge around confidential computing. Feel free to ask questions anytime as we go. I'm not able to read the chat right now unless I have to switch to screen. So I keep on going. If there are questions, please go in voice. Otherwise, I will catch up with questions in the chat at the end. So what I want to do now is go a bit more into the detail of that technology, how it is being implemented in very, very specific applications. For example, in SQL Server 2019. SQL Server 2019, as any good database, already has solid encryption of data at rest, and also has a capability called always encrypted, which basically means that you can query a data even when that column is encrypted anytime. There is an extension to this always encrypted, which is encrypted with secure enclaves. So you have the normal always encrypted, which is basically protect your data at rest, and then you can query the data also when it's at rest. And then you have the secure enclaves, which is an addition on top of always encrypted, which not only encrypt your data, but it in the database, but it takes it away from any other application until you create an attestation. Which is a trusted communication channel with that enclave. So let me show you this in a quick demo. Here we are in SQL Server Management Studio. There are the traditional normal columns for keywords for encrypted columns that you may already be familiar if you're using SQL Server. So you encrypt with a specific column to indicate that a column has been encrypted. Now, how can we make sure that an application is using this encryption also in memory in use? So I have a super simple ASP.NET MVC application that contains some sensitive data. There is a social security number, there is a salary for different people, and there is a salary range, a filter to apply, a range in my search, in my table. So this is a filter that obviously translates as a where condition in the query. So when I execute this query, you will see that this query has a select for all the fields, and specifically there is this search pattern that contains the salary. No, in the range that was specified online between some less than and more than max salary and min salary. And this search pattern is a parameter that is completely encrypted. So even if someone is profiling this query, they cannot see the parameters that go in input and the return values in output. So even the parameters are all completely encrypted, so min salary, max salary, and the return value, as you appreciate, is completely encrypted. So even a DBA with access to a SQL Server profiler can see the query, I cannot see the values. How that works? Well, SQL Server have done something very clever. They have basically built an enhanced client driver. This driver, you will use a driver to connect to your database, is able to connect to a SQL instance running in an enclave because has obtained a certificate from the attestation server to authorize to encrypt and decrypt this information when it is used. So your application, which is here symbolically identified by this C, by this C colon dash symbol, whatever your application is a web application, is a command line application. You communicate in plain text, but as soon as your query is sent to the SQL driver, it is encrypted and ciphertext sent to SQL. So SQL will understand what you are sending in an encrypted way, and it doesn't have to decrypt this data to send it back. Because it's running inside an enclave, the enclave is able to process this information already encrypted. So there is no decryption process that happens in place. So all that run inside the enclave. The enclave will take care of understanding what is this encrypted text, which is your query with all the parameters, and then return this to SQL Server again in encrypted format. There is support for very rich queries, so you can do ranges like, and the secure enclave works also with the initial encryption. So even if you do the always encrypted, this is a capability that the enclave will support. So even if you don't do the enclave, the encryption at SQL Server level will still be valid, but the enclave is basically taking this data and without this transferring outside of the database itself, decrypt internally for then returning a value in encrypted way. So if you take a debugger and try to see what the memory stack in use by SQL Server, then for that query, then you will see something like the screenshot that you have here in this slide is completely invisible, completely opaque. So even browsing the memory of an enclave with a debugger reveals nothing. Now, there is a challenge here though. The challenge here is, okay, there is this driver, this SQL driver that connects to the database, and this database has a sort of a secure tunnel of communication, or this data is encrypted, then decrypted inside the enclave and processed back in an encrypted format. So this is the way the communication happens. But there is a problem. How can we make sure that this client is authorized to talk to this SQL database? Well, we need a form of attestation. We need a way to say, hey, you client driver, SQL client driver, you are authorized to talk to the enclave. So there is another component on top of a TEE which is an attestation service. An attestation service basically makes the connection between the client and the enclave. Only if you are signed or certificated by the attestation service, you are able to communicate with the enclave and no one else. There are three ways of obtaining this attestation. First of all, the attestation service is a Windows server that runs HGS, Host Guardian Service. There are three ways of getting this attestation, as said. The first one is just by identifying you as an admin in Active Directory. So you create a trust between an Active Directory admin role and your trusted execution environment, in this case, SQL Server. Now, this one is okay, but not the most robust way of doing it. So it's recommended for quick prototyping, for building a lab and POC, because you can easily configure a role in Active Directory, but at the same time, you can easily abuse of this role in Active Directory. If someone has access to Active Directory and assign the same role to themselves and they're not authorized to do so. So it's okay for testing, for a quick prototype, but it's not the preferred way of going it. A better way is to use a proper key-based mechanism where you share a key with the host, or the host will give the client a key to protect, to certificate the secure tunnel. It's slightly better than the Active Directory because Active Directory is purely based on some matter of configuration. Here instead, you have to transfer a key and you have to obtain that key, that certificate. But still, it's not the perfect way of doing it because, again, sharing a key can be compromised. So the ideal way is to base this on hardware so that you link this security to the Intel SGX extension. This is the recommended way for to go in for a production environment. So very quick recap, Active Directory, you can use it to verify your identity. So by being member of a group, then you can quickly obtain attestation, but use this modality only until you get to a proper to a proper protection based on hardware or virtualization in general or at hypervisor level. The second way is to using a mechanism of keys, asymmetric keys between the host and the client for cryptography. This is a common practice in the cryptography space, and it's typically very secure because you have your own private key, but again, your key can potentially be compromised, even if the private key shouldn't be, but potentially can be. So in this case, again, use it, but be aware that the ultimate protection you get with a trusted platform module, which is basically a way to say, I'm sealing the encryption key at inside a chip, inside the CPU or this extension to the CPU, and only application that run on that VM with that TPM, so that trusted platform module, can access my enclave. So it's very, very isolated, very, very secure, and no one else can access it. Now, the driver, the SQL driver, the enhanced SQL driver, is not the normal SQL driver that you get when you build an application that connects to database, to SQL database. It's a specialized and enhanced driver that is using the Open Enclave SDK technology. The Open Enclave SDK is an open source SDK that contains a number of APIs currently in C++, So there is no managed version for .NET because you operate at very low level. As said, it's all open source. So openenclave.io for you to get started, and GitHub repository is the one that you see on screen, github.com/Microsoft/openenclave. Okay, so if you want to build an application that runs that connects to an openenclave, you can do that with SQL Server, with always encryption, with secure enclaves. So you don't have to do any coding with the openenclave, it is already done, so that enhanced client can do that protection for you. But if you don't want to use a SQL Server and there is no existing driver, then you need to code this driver with the openenclave SDK. Now, let me show you, I promise at the beginning that I will show you this in action. So this machine learning algorithm is running in an openenclave. And this enclave is accessed by different parties, by different health institutes. These health institutes are encrypting their patient data with the key of the enclave and sending these to the enclave itself. There is always a one-to-one association, so no other health institute can take the data and decrypt it. And also because you are signing with a key that is associated to that hospital, to that institute, you know where the patient data is coming from. At the end, this machine learning algorithm that is running inside a trusted execution environment can merge all the different data sets. And if you are familiar with machine learning, especially the algorithm of regression, classification, they look into patterns of historical data. So the more data you have, the better, the higher is the accuracy. So the way it works basically is I have a CSV file that contains some patient data for the hospital A, okay? And this data I'm gonna encrypt. So these numbers that you see on the left mean something to the hospital, the patient data, and then I'm going to encrypt this and in data that I can read. Then I sign in into a fictional portal that I built only for the sake of testing this. But pretend this is the connection to, you know, the machine learning enclave. Upload the encrypted file. So if you notice, the encrypted file has a 0.0 extension at the end. So I'm going to take the encrypted file and upload it. So this is a file that contains patient data to be used for training the model in machine learning. Now let me switch to Hospital B, and I do this by going to another desktop. I have the same data, I mean, I have a data set for the Hospital B that contains patient data for the Hospital B. I'm going to do the same process. So encrypt this patient data, sign in the same application, but with user B, so with the Hospital B, and upload the encrypted data set. So then now we have two data set encrypted inside the enclave where machine learning is running. So let me go back to my desktop one and let's see, okay, let's do now a training of this model. Okay, so if I go into the process for machine learning to do the training, you see that I have a model that is being generated out of the dataset A, so the dataset that I used initially. The evaluation of that model will generate an accuracy of 84%. But if I combine together, so the shared model with also the dataset B, the accuracy goes up to 97%. case of the local model, only the A hospital has produced an accuracy of 84%. By combining the model, the two together, then the accuracy goes up. And the more data set I add, the higher is the accuracy of prediction. Still, the two data set are completely separate, encrypted, and none of the hospital can read this information. It's only the machine learning algorithm can access that because it's running in this trusted execution environment. All right, we are at the end. I want to leave some time for a few questions. There are a couple of articles on the Microsoft MSDN magazine that I wrote some time ago. The magazine is being archived for now, but data is still available on Microsoft Docs. Let me share this URL in the chat. Hello there. So I'll put this in the chat. You will also have access to the slide. Oh gosh, that came out very big. Here we go. I guess that's it. Thank you. I want to share my social coordinates. You'll find me on LinkedIn, find me on Twitter. I'll stay around for this event for the rest of the day. So feel free to get in touch anytime. Now, let me see if there are any questions. Okay, then we prevent the infinite loop effect here. Okay, no specific questions. Go ahead in voice so I can try to answer some in the few minutes that we have.
So this is fairly new to myself, so this is quite an interesting one. So my question is, you're referring to, security of data in memory, and the only what I've seen you demo now, it's kind of really majorly SQL Server. So what about things like when you're doing like development? I know you've got encrypted memory objects or encrypted memory what do you call it modules and stuff like in .NET and stuff. So does that also apply to
So,
application?
I see where you're coming from. The answer is yes, it does protect also application running in memory. The only thing is to get data out of the enclave, you need to have a certified connection that you
Okay.
get from the attestation service.
Okay, so that's that level. Okay.
Yes, so that is where SQL Server has already built that trusted client for you, so that you don't have to build that level of connection to get the data out of the enclave. So you just use the driver and you just use normal SQL queries. If you're running a .NET application in memory and you want to do that, so you want to extract data out of the enclave, you need to build your client using the OpenEnclave SDK. Obtain a certificate from the attestation service, and then you can access the data inside whatever technology you're using in the enclave.
I got it. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Cheers.
All right, in the interest of time, and because we have another speaker coming up now, I will say thank you very much. I hope this sparked